I hope you're enjoying the conference so far. I know I am. Thank you for being here today. My name is Céline, and I'm the team lead for Code for Life at Ocado. But I wasn't always a team lead. I was also a little girl once, a long time ago. Okay, I was pretty geeky when I was a kid, so most kids love dinosaurs, and I was one of them. I really knew everything about them. I loved them. It was amazing. But I also love things like mazes and microscopes. When I say I love mazes, I didn't like to solve them. I like to actually create some. So I would spend like summer break just drawing mazes and then like asking my parents nicely to solve them. And it was so fun. Really would fight for getting the microscope at Christmas and things like that. But well, I also like to play dolls with one of my friends. She had this big dollhouse, pretty pink, right? But my main issue at that time was, where are the stairs? Where are the stairs, or maybe the lifts, or the boulders, or the ladders, or whatever? Where are they? So my friend was like, well, I don't care, I don't mind. I just take the doll with my hand and put it myself on the second floor. I was like, no, it doesn't make sense. Do you want me to build you a lift? And she was like, no. Okay. So yeah, it was a bit geeky. Fine, we get it. But it's nice to be like a bit geeky, but if you really want to pursue a career in science or technology, at some point you also need mentors, and I think I was really lucky to get some incredible mentors, such as this primary school teacher. That's an actual picture from when I was 9, so that's why it's blurred. This guy was amazing. So we actually were in a destitute area in the north of Paris, in the northern suburbs of Paris. And it was 1994, but still none of us had ever seen a computer at this time. This man made sure that we would get some. So what he did is that he just went, and I think he just asked some companies there or things like that, but to bring us some second-hand computers so we could actually see them and work with them. And we were doing things like, you know, drawing and writing poems, and he said, well, what don't you just put it on like Word or Paint, and then I'm gonna print them out, put them in the classroom. And at this time it was amazing for us. He also taught us a lot about like the theory of evolution. He brought us newts so that we could take, yeah, really cool, so that we could take care of them. I think this person was like a great inspiration. I didn't have like so many friends, and I'm an only child, so I didn't have like any siblings to also act as like older children mentors, but I had my cousins, and I also want to thank them, obviously. They would just show me things like Pac-Man or games, teach me more about how to unleash my creativity, but also magical tricks, and they were really amazing. But mostly I was a bookworm. I was always reading something. You might know that it's Tintin. It's a comic book. This one is Destination Moon, and I think that's where I learned my first concept of like nuclear physics. Here it's like a pretty dramatic view of the space rocket, but there are some pages which are less dramatic, but I loved more when they explain a lot about nuclear physics and how they make the motors of the rocket. And Captain Haddock is like, yeah, what is that? And I really loved it. So at this point, I guess I sort of wanted to become a physicist, but anyway, I just loved that. But if you really look closely at this book, and I would say all the Tintin book in general, there are not a lot of women or people of color. So here, the people working to build the rocket are only white males. Now, at this time, I didn't mind so much because I knew there were some role models that I could find. But I don't know what would have happened because it's really good for kids to grow with role models that really help you understand that you can do something. And I think I knew I could be a physicist or a scientist just because Marie Curie was like a model that I knew existed, and my mom told me a lot about her, and I was like, oh, gosh, this woman is amazing. So I think that real-life physicists were probably more important than comic book physics, but still. Yet I wanted to become like a lot of different things when I was a kid. So I say I really loved science, but I also wanted to become a writer. I wanted to become an actor too at some point, I guess. I should have put singer too because I wanted to be that when I was four, but that was probably the worst idea of them all, so that's great. Also, I was interested in becoming an exobiologist. I don't know if any one of you know what an exobiologist is. Sort of. Okay, those are people that study alien life forms or the possibility of alien life forms. And it sounded really cool, so I was like, oh yeah, I want to do that so badly. Then I looked a bit into it and I discovered that basically they were looking for meteorites to arrive on Earth. Then we just analyze it, check for organic matter, say, oh no, not this time, bye, see you next year. And I was like, yeah, maybe, it's, I don't know, not that much. I also loved ancient Egypt and wanted to become an Egyptologist. Until I watched this documentary when there were some people that were trying to ask a peasant in Egypt to get rid of his field so they could just search what was there. And it was the only way for this person to just feed his family. And I was like, yeah, I think that real life people are probably more important. So that's also when I stopped, I think. So I had a hard time choosing the French equivalent of A-levels or GCSE. I really hesitated between science and literature a lot. Spoilers, I chose science. So obviously I had this calculator for more advanced math, a programmable calculator. Well, some of my friends used it to cheat at exams. Okay, I'm not pointing the fingers. Who did that in the room? Good. Well, I used it mostly to actually program games. That when I realized that there was an actual thing called like a programming language. This was basic, but I programmed things like a dichotomy, random things that I would ask my friend to play with, and programmed a minesweeper too once, which has like the worst user experience ever, but I was still proud of it. And then I was like, yeah, yeah, okay, computer science, that seems like something I really like, and that would probably allow me, if I want to at some point, go back to archaeology or exobiology even, whatever, because really computer science is used in lots of fields, and I just discovered that at this time, was quite late. Now that's just still my own personal experience. And if I remember correctly, I might be mistaken, but if I remember correctly, my high school in the last year of science, we were about 50% of women. Which I think is also quite unusual in France, but I think that's the figure that we had. However, if you look at my next step in my education, which was my preparatory class for engineering school, you can see the figure dropping to 20%. So yeah, I think we were about 10 in a class of 50 person. So I also don't know if you are familiar with the French system. It's kind of weird. I'm just saying that. Well, after your 18-year-old diploma, you can go to uni, but you can also choose another path for science or sales or economics, for instance, which are schools, grade schools, they are called in French. And for the most prestigious one, you have to go to a preparatory class for 2 or 3 years. And then you are allowed to go to the contest that will accept you to the school. So I was accepted in, I think it was one of the most difficult preparatory class in France. Still, I remember there were a couple of guys that were making nasty comments about the grades of the few women in the class. And at this time, I was like, yeah, you know, they're just them, they're just bad people, but they're just not the majority of people. It was still very nasty. Now, that's just my own personal experience, but if you look at actual statistically relevant figures, on the left are figures from France. So basically, after a science-specific high school, 31% of the women there choose a path in hard science and technology for 53% of men. So that might explain where the drop came from. And in the UK, because I live in the UK now, among people graduating from computer science uni, 13% are women. Now, Microsoft did a very interesting study quite recently about when girls start to lose interest in STEM subjects. So this one is actually about when they start becoming interested in them, and it's at about 11-year-old in most of Europe. But the drop is at 15-year-old. So there's something happening there that makes them lose their interest in this topic. Now, they also try to understand what are the main factors that might keep them interested in this topic, and are things like having a role model that you can identify with, having teacher mentors, having teacher things that helped me too when I chose this path, right? Having something which is grounded, etc. On the left, it's a picture of Agathe. Agathe is actually my boyfriend's best friend, and she is one of the co-founders of Women on Rails, which is dedicated to mentoring women into working and discovering Ruby. And she told me that actually when she was really young, she was really bad at math, because actually she was bad at theoretical math. But she had some teachers tell her that you will never be able to become like a programmer, you're so bad at math, and anyway you were a woman. It really happened to her. And yet she's now a very good developer. So she goes back and speaks in school and explains that actually it's possible and that you can do it. And she realized actually she was good at math, but at grounded math. So yeah, I told you about the French system and the engineering school. So ENSTAR Paris Tech was my engineering school. It's a great school because actually, the first year you still do a bit of everything, and I loved it. So even art history, quantum physics, computing, probability. It's like, yay, okay, I have to choose something next year. Yeah, okay, computer science and robots, that's awesome. So that's what I did. It's also noteworthy that we were a record-breaking number of 40% of women in this year, and I think it was the record-breaking year in the whole of France for the engineering schools at that time, and also for that school. Later on, it just dropped to about 30%, which I think is the current ratio now in France for most engineering schools. Then I had an internship in Exalit, which was awesome, because I was working on statistical computational linguistics. So I loved languages. Love computing was like, yay, a mix of both was awesome. It was a really great team. And then I actually spent 7 years in Aldebaran, which is now SoftBank Robotics. So Aldebaran was at this time a French startup which was creating robots. You can see the pictures of the robots there, really cute. This one is called Now. Yeah, it was 7 really good years. I started as an app developer for the robots, and I was the only full-time female software engineer at this time in the company. We were a company of about 40 people at this time. And then in 2013, I was promoted as a team lead, and I was the first or one of the few, I don't remember, but female software leads at this time. So, really good to work with all those cute robots, right? But also, something interesting is that all those experiences, and then after that, moving to the UK, made me realize a lot of things that I didn't really realize before. So just to tell you what was my mindset like about 10 years ago, I thought the world should be like magical, just rainbows and unicorns and being all magical. I thought that it made no sense for people not to be tolerant with each other. But I think that I thought that the world should change magically to that, basically. I didn't know why, because it didn't, just didn't make any sense. And also, I enjoyed being an outsider. So when I told you about the figures that we were 20% of women in my preparatory class, at this time, actually, I didn't see it as a problem. I sort of felt a bit special, or, you know, it's fine. I don't know why it happens, but it's fine, sure. I did change my mind later on. There are a lot of things that happen. Things that happened to me personally, things that happened to some of my friends, and also I started reading a lot about topics about diversity, and really helped change my mind about the fact that, yeah, we still want to go from A to B, B being the ideal world, but that won't happen magically. You have to do something. There are a lot of things right now you can hear about, for instance, all the sexual harassment cases in Uber and things like that. Well, to be fair, things like that happened to me and most of my female friends in the industry. It is something that happens. I'm mostly focused about gender here, but there are other problems, obviously, not just with gender. For instance, we were at some point trying out a face recognition algorithm on our robot. So it was a third-party software that we were using. And it works quite well until we ask our black colleague to come and try it. And suddenly the robot just couldn't recognize him. And we're like, oh, that's not great. I wonder why it happens. Oh, wait, I know. There's also the fact that most young girls now will have heard about all those issues. So it might be difficult to actually engage them into choosing this path. So that might explain back the 20% figures that we had previously. It's not being special or anything. So that's what I learned. And maybe now if we can do something about it, maybe we can go back to our ideal world. Okay, are you stuck? No, it's fine. There's something else that also helped me change my mind a lot, was when I was working in Aldebaran on a project to help children with autism. So we were creating games and apps on the robot, as well as a website for to help the teachers create playlists of applications that will help the kids with their learning goals. So really, the robot wasn't here at all to replace the teacher. It was a tool, as they would use like iPads and things like that to write. The idea behind it is the robot is like a good interface between like a phone or a tablet and a human being. So it might be easier for them to apply what they learn on the robot to, for instance, human beings, etc. Also, the robot is really repetitive, so it will always say the same thing, exactly the same way, over and over again, without getting angry or judgmental, and that's a good plus. So maybe I will show you a picture, a video, if I manage to click. Can you hear?
What if a developer could help teach a nonverbal child how to communicate with loved ones? What if an animator could bridge a habitual child to an ever-evolving community? What if a researcher could implement innovative technology to minimize overstimulation in children and improve learning? What if these people and others from around the world came together on a journey to transform the classroom? Combining talents to shape a better path for special education by allowing children to take their learning to the next level, opening up a world of possibilities. help shape the path and become a part of the journey.
Sorry. So yeah, this was quite great project to work for, and I think that it really changed our lives as much as hopefully we changed some of those kids' lives. I still remember being in a class in Massachusetts, so I think that's the class that you can see up there. And there was this kid that wouldn't look us in the eye when she was greeting us. And we put the robot in front of her, and she started to focus directly on the robot, and it was quite a great thing to see. And apparently, a few weeks later, she started to pay attention to other things, like a drawing of a frog on the door, and started to greet it in the morning. So kudos to the people I work with there, for instance, Jesse and Alexandra. Alexandra being the woman on the bottom left. She also has an association in Romania that helps kids with autism, and she's an amazing person. Now, usually when I talk about that, people ask me why I left Aldebaran and why I'm in the UK now. First, I just wanted a change, I guess, after 7 years there. Also, it was a dream to move to London. Still, it's difficult to find something as cool as the robot. Hey, but I found Code for Life, yoo-hoo. So Code for Life, it's a non-profit initiative that delivers and free and open source coding games to help all kids learn computing. That's the mission statement of the project. Now, people in the UK know about Ocado. Ocado is an online supermarket, so usually the reaction is like, wait, what? Why is Ocado doing that? Here is why. Actually, behind Ocado, there's Ocado Technology. It's a technology company, and it's really keen on helping with education. Also, there's an Ocado Foundation is only in Ocado, and we're under the umbrella of the foundation. In 2014, the UK decided to introduce computing in the primary school curriculum, and I think it was the first country to do so. So that was a group of volunteers at Ocado started to develop some coding games to help the kids, but also the teacher, to help the teacher teach the kids, basically. I think that our CTO just put it very nicely there, so it's a long quote, so I won't read it. But basically talking about learning how to program as just the basics of learning that is like a useful skill for like anyone, especially in our world today. Now, there are some really good people that talked about that, and the videos will be in my slides, so you can watch them later. One is Linda Leukas. She wrote the Hello Ruby book, which she calls a delightful way to teach kids about computers, and she got some really nice quotes. One is, little girls don't know they are not supposed to like computers, so yeah. And also, if we change a kid's perception of what's possible, we can change the entire world. So yeah, this idea is that if you manage to teach the kids at an early age, maybe you will have more kids understand the power of computing and also enjoy just enjoying it and just know that maybe it's actually for them. So that would be nice. Another brilliant talk is by Kat Lamin. It was at PyCon UK last year, which was an amazing conference. I don't know if you were there. She just explained a lot about why do kids need to learn computing, and she also talks about the fact that when it's grounded, it's really good. Some kids really love games, and the fact that they can see it as related to games or programming games will really interest them. The thing is that, yeah, I said we were actually teaching the teachers how to teach computing. Like, why is that? So first, most of the teachers, when the UK put computing in the curriculum, was like, okay, I have no idea what's happening there. Some of them were afraid that the kids might be better than they are at computing. They didn't feel really confident enough. A cat have a lack of resources, of energy, really. I think it's more mental energy even than just time. Then if they just go online and try to find some resources, here I can think it's like 25 million last time I checked, so they're like, okay, what is going on? So that explains why we're trying to do some tools that would be useful for both, really. So the first game is Rapid Router. It's a game for primary school, which teaches Blockly and Python. So Blockly is a visual programming language, which really is like Scratch, which is open source and created by Google. And Python, what is that language? Oh, yes, sorry. The idea is really to have a progression in making them understand the computing concept. So it's just not learning about syntax, it's learning about logical thinking and algorithm. So I can either show you a video of me playing the game, or I can do a live coding session. Okay, live coding it is. Wait, maybe the answers are cached somewhere. I'm gonna cheat. Just a moment. It's going to be interesting without the screen mirror. Come on. I think I messed up with the settings. Yay. So this is Rapid Router. And this is the first level of Rapid Router, which is very difficult, as you're gonna see. Yay, not cheating, see? So the idea is you program a van to go alongside the road, and at first you only have like a very limited set of Blockly blocks.
Sorry. Yay.
Live coding is working. Thank you.
Where's my mouse now? Oh, it's back. Okay.
Another thing is the next level of this episode are just a bit more difficult in terms of the route, but you still have a very small number of blocks that you can use. So, for instance, if you go to level 12, you can see that the route is slightly more complicated, and yet you only have to like copy paste, move forward, turn left, turn right, like quite a number of times. So that's why I actually won't do it. Not yet, but spoilers: the project is open source. Now, the thing is, it might get quite a bit boring to copy-paste all those things. So after, when we actually teach loops, loops and conditions, it actually makes sense, because then they can just use a repeat loop to make it happen, and they're like, oh, I don't have to copy-paste everything 100 times. I love repeat loops. So it's just grounded knowledge. It's not just like, say, so you've got like a for loop and then it happens and you're boring. No, it's just grounded and they understand the need of that in quite a deep way. And after that, we actually go to Python, but I would say in a progressive way. So there are episodes which are Blockly to Python episodes. Stay here, thanks. So introduction to Python. Here's Python, yay! And you can see everything is auto-completed, that's so easy. But you can see that you program in Blockly, but you can see what it looks like in Python. Semi-prepared live coding, that's what it's called. And it just works the same. And later on, you just program directly in Python. So, but they're getting used to it thanks to those episodes. So just all that knowledge being very progressively done. So the first levels are really 5-6 year olds. We also have like unplugged activity for the teachers that they can print, especially for the kids that can't read. And those later episodes are more for 10, 11 years old. I'll try to go back to the presentation. That's for me, thanks. I love live demos. So yeah, we do offer those unplugged activities for the teachers, but we also offer a lot of PDFs with teaching materials and things like that that they can really use to really not to have to create exercises, really. So we have one teacher that told us once, this teacher, we really love Code for Life because we don't have to teach. Well, no, it's fine. Can I quote you? that's weird. Most of those materials were created thanks to Sharon Harrison. She was our education consultant at the beginning of the project, and she was an awesome lady, and sadly she left us in 2015. So the new redesign of website is dedicated to her, and she was an incredible role model for teachers and for the kids she worked with. Now talking about role models, I don't know if you saw the video when I was playing the loops episode. There was a video that popped out that I closed. But we do have lots of videos like that in the project, and it's actually Ocado people talking about what they do at Ocado and then explaining the concepts, like this one, for instance.
Hi, everyone. Today I'm with Helen Mead, senior software engineer at Ocado Technology. Helen, please tell us a little bit about what you do.
Yeah, sure. My job is to write the software that helps us to keep track of your shopping from the point at which it leaves our warehouse up until it arrives at your house. This includes the software on drivers' handheld devices, which tells them the order in which they need to drop shopping off, how to get to customers' houses, which items are in the van, and whereabouts that shopping is. I write code every day and use lots of different programming languages that you'll be learning about in future, like Java and Python.
What's next in the app for us all?
The next bit of the app uses if-else statements, which are a bit like the if statements you've been using so far. Just like if statements, if-else statements help computers make decisions, but in a slightly more clever way. They let the computer check two or more things when deciding what to do. We all use if-else statements in everyday life. For example, if it's a weekday, you know you need to go to school, but if it's not, you know that you can stay at home. Just like with the if statement block, you can tell the van to turn right if there is a road to the right. But if there's no road to the right, then the van can't move forward. The if else statement lets you say that if there is no road to the right, then the van needs to turn left. That way the van can decide which way it needs to go on its own and find its way to the house without you having to put in every single step.
That's great. Thanks, Helen. I'll give it a go now. If else statements sound cool, I'm going to learn more about them. Are you?
So yeah, those funny videos can actually help create role models for the kids, because you see all kinds of people at work at Ocado and explain about what they do, and that can be really motivating to see someone from the industry telling you what they do and explain you fun concepts in this nice way. That's something we're actually trying to do more, so we'll try later to get maybe some more videos and print them better in our website, for instance. Speaking of which, we actually did a lot of user interviews in the past year because we wanted to redo our main portal, because it looked like the thing on the left. That's the main website where the teachers can log in, register their classes, etc. And it was a bit gray. People would just click on the big Rapid Router picture. What would you expect when clicking on the Rapid Router picture? To go to Rapid Router, maybe? Well, no, just did nothing. So our users were a bit confused. So we spent, James, which is our awesome UX designer, spent a lot of time talking to teachers and also kids to make sense of what we needed to change, really. So that's why it looks like the website on the right now, since the 20th of June. So it's quite recent. Now, things is, on the left, you have a screenshot of an example of a Python code from Rapid Router in one of the last levels. Still, it's quite different if you look at the Python code from our code base, as you can see on the right. It's not so different, but still, you've got the Django framework, you've got object-oriented programming, you're like, yeah, okay. We don't really teach that to the 11-year-old in Rapid Router. Not yet. But we are working on a game for the 12 to 16, which has a very cool working name of AI MMO, or IMO, which actually means Artificial Intelligence Massively Multiplayer Online. It's a code name, so I don't know what it's going to be called yet, which is really for secondary school pupils. The idea is to teach also Python and also artificial intelligence in a really fun way. Now, we did a lot of user research with teenagers, but also with teachers, because if the game appeals to teenagers, it's fine, but if the teachers think it's awful, they will never use it in schools, and that's also what we want to do. We spoke with someone from Computing at School, which is a group in the UK, which is quite great. And she told us, okay, but it's a nice idea that you have, but just pay attention and make sure that all the kids will love it, etc. And we're like, okay, we did some more research. And we're like, well, it looks like everyone at their age seemed to like game. And then we actually dug a bit deeper, and we found all this research about, for instance, the fact that it's a good article that you can also read. It's a link on the right. About how GCSE leaves girls, as we already saw, and poorer kids behind. A colleague of us, which was actually a volunteer at Code for Life, told us that, well, if at his time he could have taken computing, like before he was 16, he actually probably wouldn't, because he didn't have a computer at home. It was quite difficult to then do your exercises, etc., if you don't really have materials. And apparently it just happens that they actually are left away because of that, which means that if you don't think that you can become good enough until you can go to uni, for instance, then you don't do computing at uni, and you are really left behind, which is awful. As for the girls, well, we saw what happened. Apparently they all heard about the problems that might happen in the industry, and they don't necessarily want to live through that. So it's some sort of a vicious circle that's going on. So we really try to pay more attention to what we were doing in terms of products and UX. There's something that we came up with, so which ID for the game should we have, which story should we have behind? So it's really like story based, and we decided to go with a time travel ID. So my Doctor Who dress. I love time travel, so it's great. but the idea with that is that we could have different maps for levels. You have like a screen grab of our futuristic level here, which is also just a work in progress. Might not look like that at all, it's a mock-up. But you could like build your own time machine and maybe go back in the past, which means that we could have a lot of different areas that might appeal to everyone depending on your taste. So we could have like a dinosaur level. We could have Heian Japan. We could have ancient Egypt. We could have a lot of things, and Victorian England, etc. Steampunk. Also, it started as an idea which was really challenging, but also competitive, and we are trying to find ways to incorporate more collaboration with the kids to make them also learn about teamwork and make it nicer. Trying also to make sure that they will be able to create an avatar that look like them. So for instance, this avatar is now called Evil Céline. Evil Céline. Céline, it's me, so that's Evil Céline. That's my evil twin, according to James. Some other next steps that we have, for instance. First, we have about 100,000 users. Proud. But still, the website is right now only in English. So what we did is that we opened our project, we opened translations for our project on crowding, so everybody can go and help translate the project. There will be links on the last slide. For instance, we found out that we have a lot of users that come from Brazil. So that would be really awesome if we could get all the translation done in Portuguese, Brazilian, for instance. We're also planning on having an iOS app for Rapid Router because first we found out in Google Analytics that a lot of teachers use iPads, but also it's easier to make an offline game, which means that the kids that are not allowed to go to internet at home can still play. But also in terms of accessibility. So one of the teachers that we met told us that the kids that can't use a mouse, for instance, they might be really grateful to be able to play Rapid Router without a mouse. We also started, I hope it's going to be soon, I don't know, we're starting a partnership with the Essex Library Services. So Essex is a region in Britain. And the council have all those libraries, and they want to put a shortcut for Code for Life on all the computers in the libraries, and that would be great for instance, the kids or the adults, because it's a fun game for everyone, that don't have access to internet or computers at home. Well, they can still play there. Yes, time travel, it's awesome. Sometimes I really wished I could time travel. I sort of wish that maybe instead of having all those rows of pink toys for girls with real dollhouses with no stairs, I had things like Goldie blocks. I don't know if you know that, it's amazing. I mean, come on, like Invention Mansion. So those are actually games which were created a few years ago in the US. And really, you can build your own thing. It's really to teach engineering to young girls, and it's amazing. I actually want one, so I'm trying to find an excuse to buy one. Maybe I don't know. But it's so good to want to travel back in the past. But maybe we should think about traveling to the future and try to make sure that it's a good world that we're going to reach. So make sure that all those tools that we wish we had, we actually are programming them for the next generations. Making sure that instead of like one or two role models that you might identify with, here I put Ada Lovelace, you have a whole bunch of mentors and mentoring organizations that help you. Here I put just a tiny few of people and organizations that I know that I think are doing a great job for diversity and helping the current and new generations. for instance, on the top with the robot. This is Angelica. She has a PhD in robotics and she works at SoftBank Robotics. She's an amazing woman and she talks at events and at Women in Tech events. Of course, you might know Anne-Marie Imafiden, the creator of STEMETS and former child genius. Agathe, that I already told you about, Linda Leukas, Alexandra, Helen from Ocado. Also, on the bottom left is Ose. He's a colleague of mine, and he's a mentor for Amos Bursary, which is a charity in the UK dedicated to help black British men which are academically able and really to mentor them. So he's also an awesome person. Obviously, Django Girls by Ladies, amazing. So those are the mentors of today, and maybe you can be the mentors of today and tomorrow. The Code for Life volunteers, I think there are such people. They are really awesome, and they're really dedicated to really making sure that they inspire back the generation of kids as we might have wished we were inspired before. We're also having a lot of fun when we code together. On the picture, you can see all those great people. For instance, James, our UX designer, Chris, that helped create the game. Ruth, she's our front-end mentor. Niket and Jack, and they help on the iOS app, etc. Everyone is doing something great. Or Andrea, which is our data scientist volunteer. On bottom right are our Polish volunteers from Ocado Poland. They are involved in Code for Life, but also in activities such as Green Life for Girls or Mind the Gap. And also, we have a pet dinosaur. This is Tracy. Tracy is actually our token in our stand-up meetings with the team. We talk to it sometimes. I think we're really like a team dedicated to make things change. Actually, the project was nominated this year at the Women in IT Awards, which was quite proud of it at this time. Really learning also, because it's actually a meta-learning project. They teach children while learning themselves things, so some of them actually taught themselves Python to work on that project. Really, the idea is to create games that will manage to reach all the kids before they choose their GCSE level, before they choose their A-levels, and to make sure that we manage to inspire them at this point in life before their interest dropped, for instance. But there are still, there are still a lot more to do. So if you want to know more about the project or maybe even get involved, here is the cheat sheet with all the contact details. So the website, social media, but also our GitHub links, there are quite a few, and our translation platform. Thank you.
All right, anybody have questions? I have a microphone.
Hello. Do you have any data how many people from those who started to use the program to teach themselves programming, how many finish to the next level and how many of them actually continue to like grow as developers?
We don't have that data yet, so the project was started in 2014 for primary school kids, so they are not there yet. We have, I don't remember the figure, but we have a few people that register as independent students. It's also something you can do in a program, so you're not part of a school, but if you want to learn programming without all the cheat things that the teachers have in their account, you can do that, but we don't register their age when they do that. But we're hoping that in 10 years, they will become that.
Thanks for the presentation, very nice. Do you have data or do you know how many children are registered today in these coding programs and What do you think, how many you can reach in the future?
So right now we have about 100,000 users, which are mostly children, because the ratio for teachers is different. So we have, I would say, near 90,000 children all over the world which are registered. Then there are a few more that probably use it without being registered, but that's difficult to understand the overlap. Now, I would say I would like to have like billions in the future, but yeah, we're trying to do it one step at a time, but first making sure that we also inspire the teenagers and more people in the world by hopefully having translations.
So at first, let me thank you for your work. I have a daughter, so I'm pretty sure that helps. Can you elaborate a bit how it relates to other initiatives in Europe, like Code Your Life or so on? Do you work with them together, or is there some kind of exchange of ideas between you and them?
Sorry, I didn't get the question.
I think there's something called Code Your Life. My kids are pretty small, but I think the elementary school, who my older boy goes to, work together with Code Your Life, which is sounds really like you, but just, I think it's sponsored by Microsoft or whatever.
Oh, I don't know about it. That's code.org too, which is...
Use Google Code Your Life. I think it's a Microsoft initiative. They use Turtle instead of the car thing, also with this building blocks programming, and also especially for kids, I think.
Yeah, I'll check. Thanks.
Other questions?
With the current system, is it possible for the kids to actually design their own patterns and then implement solutions? And if this is possible, can they communicate with each other to like discuss these solutions and like maybe help each other to learn?
So right now they can do different things. So for instance, they can create their own levels and they can share it with the class and the teachers. So program their own map, so they design the road and they put all the props like the trees, etc. They can choose the blocks, or if it's Python, etc. Now, most of teachers actually use the levels in a collaborative way, so they actually ask the kids to collaborate on some levels and work together, so like pair programming, really, in front of rapid router, so they do that a lot. Now, we don't have that implemented as, for instance, like a chat or whatever, for security reasons, so no one can talk to the kid like that. However, we had a very nice idea, thanks to some teenagers, for our new game. So the new game for teenagers, they suggested that we pre-program some comments that they could send to each other, so that nobody would actually hack them to send some bad messages and still communicate a bit, so that's interesting.
Thank you. Very interesting talk.
Thank you.
From my experience in the industry, the biggest fear of women not coming to the industry is because they are afraid that it's a male-dominated world and they cannot make it. I want to learn, what is your impression? Why do you think it's happening that you don't see many women in the IT industry?
So I think, as I might have said earlier, there's a thing about the lack of role models that they can identify with, a vicious circle going on if they know that there will be a minority and that maybe some sexist comments might happen and things like that, they might be afraid to actually join. So there are a lot of things like that which are happening. Also, some people I know, they were being told from early childhood that it was a male thing, and so if you are not strong-minded enough, you might just not want to do that. So if you ask me, that's a bit difficult because I am still in the industry. So it's difficult for me to also relate to people that are not there. We were talking about that with some colleagues about that. I know that for me, for instance, I was just very strong-minded when I was a kid, and I was like, no, you can't tell me I can't do that, I will do it. But you can't ask everyone to be like that. That's not possible. If you are privileged, you have to make an effort to include other people. That's how it should work. So I think that's mostly why it happens. So that's why initiatives that help everyone understand that it's fun and also that they can do it and have role models, we are hoping that it might help change the balance.
Hello, thank you for your talk. Is there a program for training teachers in Python to be able to teach the children?
Sorry?
Is there a program for teaching the teachers Python in England?
Yes, so all the computing at school and barefoot computing, they are helping the teachers with getting in power with those skills. In Code for Life, what we do is that we have also all those PDFs that explain the solutions to the teachers, so they exactly know, for instance, what is the right Python code for the Python episodes to really help them make it. There's also a solve button that they have so they can see what's going on and help the kids directly when there's a problem. Yeah, there are also a lot of, I would say, a lot of other associations that I probably don't know about. But yeah, I think that computing at school, barefoot computing in the UK are quite good to help the teachers. There are also people like Kat Lamin, which talk to teachers and actually help mentor. So the BBC Microbit are also doing great things at school in the UK.
A follow-up question. So that means there's a big increase in the Python community in England?
Sorry?
Does that mean there's a big increase in the Python community in England?
I actually don't know the figures about the increase of the Python community, but that's a good point, I'll check.
Any other questions?
Thank you for your talk. My question was a bit like, why did you choose Python and not any other language to do the whole Code for Life in the game and everything?
So first, we also to teach Blockly, so that's two languages. Well, the idea is that, so I don't know the figures, but still Python is becoming really famous, and it's a bit, I think a while ago it was JavaScript which were more famous, and now it's mostly Python, so it just goes with the trend of teachers teaching it, and also there are other tools available online that teach different things, so some teachers might want to use all of them to teach different syntaxes. It's also very simple to learn because it's very user-friendly, especially if you just do a subset of Python. So we just it just makes sense. Now for the game for teenagers, we're also planning to offer Python levels. At some point we were thinking of later maybe expanding that so you could program your avatar in a different language, but we're not sure about prioritizing that right now.
Other questions? Okay, well, thank you so much.